Hundreds of wildfires continue to burn in BC.
Helicopters take turns scooping up water from Williams Lake and dumping it on a nearby ridgeline billowing with smoke. Three major fires around Williams Lake have already destroyed more than 7,000 hectares, including an unknown number of buildings.
Currently in British Columbia, there are 317 fires already burning there.
July 7th, 2017, fire erupted from the other side of the river and up jump in the river and made its way around Yunesit’in.
30% humidity and 30% the temperature, like Celsius, when they match, it's really prone to fire at that time. Like, that's excellent fire conditions.
All you could see was sort of the orange and reddish hues from 100 to 200 foot, like, fires coming towards the community.
At one point, it just sounded like a stampede of horses when the wind caught it and it was coming at us. Everybody pretty well kind of decided that our houses were gonna go. Like, you know, this is it, let's get out of the way.
It was traumatizing. It was burning.
It was incredible, the amount of fires that started everywhere all at once. So it wasn't just here, it was up north, it was everywhere.
All the resources in BC just got pulled all in the same moment as this was happening.
When it's like a rank 5 fire, you're supposed to just not even touch it. Just walk away, get everyone safe, and like wait for like helicopters to come and evacuate everyone. The guys that we had on our team, so it was like our own people as firefighters. So they broke rank and they actually went up to the subdivision and just kept fighting the fire. It was a kind of impactful moment for the community. If it was left for the government employees, they would have just let it burn.
I'm proud of our community members that stayed, that were brave enough to fight the fires to the best they could.
I was the chief at the time for Yunesit’in. I wanted to come out of it thinking, how do I prevent this from happening in the future? One of the challenges for conventional homes is you're trying to do them economically.
I noticed the way they put standards on reservations was so low. Like, it was just enough to have a shed and get out of the wind. And that's what really showed the lack of standard that Department of Indian Affairs kind of gave to our people. It's like that in every village. You'll see the same matchbox houses in every village, and you'll see the same problems.
Trying to at least start considering houses. If fires was our kind of new reality within climate change, like, just how do we design them so that, you know, people can have good air quality when there are fires, or find ways that prevent them from being easily burnt.
A lot of our people, I don't think, really dealt with the wildfire, what they went through, especially the ones that were in a community. I don't think they managed to debrief about what they went through, especially listening to the fireballs coming through the community and stuff.
Those fires continue to go right into October.
There's about 10 years of change we're going to have to deal with.
We need a safe home for these elders.
Going with the vision was that we would build one house, this, you know, wildfire prototype house, that it would be supported by the Tsilhqot’in Nation, and we'd build one, test it out, and see whether or not it's worth moving forward with a similar type of design, using all the research that came to design it, and then being able to alter it or change it or manipulate it to different needs in the future, and put a really good standard towards future Tsilhqot’in houses. The collaboration kind of turned to UBC architecture and landscape architecture to focus in on like designing a suite of different possibilities for housing. getting to the stage of developing designs that were appropriate for our environment culturally, like what are our former houses, you know, used to look like. So that started in 2016 with John Bass, and then it's sort of evolved.
Essentially, what we decided was we would take a holistic approach to the design. We used a combination of landscape elements and material to kind of provide reasonable resistance to fire, that we wanted to produce a house design that would be loved, that it would be connected to the people and daily lives of its use, and that would lead to its better maintenance and all the rest.
I think it wasn't until the 2017 wildfires happened and, you know, the Fire Awakened Us report came out, and I think John really saw that as an opportunity to take on one of the recommendations to try to build houses that were appropriate for the community, just high quality and thoughts around knowing that wildfires would be present in our environment for a long time. There was funds that were acquired and then experts that were brought on, and there was a lot more engagement on every aspect of that, of the design. It was neat to see all the best elements of people working in those different housing spaces put their best thought collaborating with this one design.
Students have been assisting Russ and I, the designers, throughout the process right from the get-go. We did a dozen or more design, kind of quite schematic designs. We did renderings showing kind of what the project would look like set in the landscape of Yunesit’in.
The way that they worked on the roof, it was like kind of an attempt to still try to maintain that cultural element. So it has a bit of a skylight. The way that its shape provides for like sort of the feel that you're still in an underground house. You know, I think just having that open space within living room and kitchen was important. The idea that our language is in jeopardy and it, you know, we need open space for the language to kind of continue to learn. In the design, a lot of the work that they came up with was often like very low tech, like in terms of like protecting a house from fire. It was a good feeling knowing that you can actually like achieve these things without having to like do like incredibly expensive things to houses. So, you know, sometimes it was like thinking about just like putting gravel at skirting around the house to like make sure that fires can't come through the grass and burn a house down, or using metal, making sure that the roof is resistant so that if there's ash that's falling or sparks that are like flying in the air, that they're not gonna like hit the roof and burn it to the ground. So simple solutions that were built around the house.
I went through a course, the carpentry program, and it was really awesome to learn the standards of how we should be building. You have to have drainage. Like, drainage is the thing that saves your home. Proper drainage around your foundation so the soil doesn't freeze and fluctuate and crack. So that's what's happened to all the little homes. Like, they're 50 years old, 60, 70 to 80, I think, is the oldest ones.
It's not just the house itself that was important, even where a lot of the work still has to be done. In anywhere that you put a design like a house like this is like just thinking of the landscape around it. Even for us, we were trying to make it culturally relevant by situating it inside the ground a bit. So using a bit of the earth itself as being kind of a buffer. So just thoughts of location and positioning and lighting, and yeah, it all kind of went into the thought of like how you would situate a house like this.
The idea that the prototype, right? Let's build one. Let's live in it. Let's figure out what's not done as well as it could be, and then do it again, better. Repeating process of building, testing, building better is really what you'd hope for in a project like this.
I feel optimistic, you know, in the sense of wanting to see like a good idea move forward, be able to sort of challenge the norms of how some houses are built. There's a lot of houses, even new houses, that are not built safely or do not consider sort of the worst elements of wildfire.
The wildfire house is as much about cultural resilience as it is about fire resilience. In fact, I think you could think of those as just one thing, two sides of the same coin.
I really want to see this building built. When you think of the need for having this project, when you think of like all the places all over Canada or the US that are potentially impacted by wildfires, you know, year by year, we hear the new droughts or the new wildfires that have come early. It's going to be this ongoing issue and problem for me. I'd like to see it built just so that we can see how can this change how, you know, people, where they put their houses or what types of designs they think of when they're thinking about living in the environment that they live in.
Wildfires are not a rural or wilderness-based issue anymore. They're very much an urban issue. We have to rethink how we are going to live with fire, not only fight it, but it's also a question of how do we design and live with what is inevitable in our urban landscapes.